of control of the pictures there to put that fandom on.
Good morning. My name is John Mollison. I interview old guys. I draw their airplanes, and I'm part of the production team of Old Guys and Their Airplanes. We're here at the San Diego Air and Space Museum in their outdoor pavilion, getting ready to interview live one of Korean War's amazing heroes, Royce Williams. Now, what you're going to see on the screen is you're going to see a number for you to text questions. But to get that, get your mind going of what kind of questions that we can ask this guy, we're going to have a little film. It's about 18 minutes, and it'll give you a background of Royce's Korean War service, but also insight into his character and the kind of person that can do something so amazing. Sit back, and in about 18 minutes, we'll be back live with Royce Williams.
Everyone seems to understand that the odds are, in some way, stacked against them. After all, there's that old phrase that no one gets out of life alive. But still, we have to face tomorrow's challenges. Well, that's the value of a hero story. They tell us that whatever it is, it can be done. Against all odds, victory can still be achieved. Still, we have to be careful that we don't get fixated on the story and forget the substance that made the story. On November 18th, in 1952, a Navy pilot was pushed into a moment where he had to defend himself against overwhelming odds, one David against seven Goliaths, in an aerial knife fight that lasted 38 minutes. And he came out on top. But if you really want to get a handle on the moment, you need to know more about the man that made it. This is the story of Royce Williams, a child of the Great Depression. He's from a tiny prairie town in South Dakota, and yet he ended up in a proxy showdown between the world's greatest military powers.
When we got on top of the clouds, they were probably 50-some thousand feet and putting out contrails. And I saw them as they were closing on us. We were headed on at each other. I called out, tally-ho, meaning I see them. I prepared to fight. Seven MiG-15s as they approached. And I said, do not engage. But I said, we are engaged. They are there, and I'm going to have to handle the situation. We lived right on the edge of town, and we had a large grove of trees next to it. I spent a lot of time over there just bird watching and so forth. But about 2 miles outside of town was a creek. But the big trick was when ice would break in the spring to see who's going to be the first one to go swimming. And I did not, but my brother did. And boy, not for long, and he came out shivering. Dumb, of course, but still talking about it. So it's those things that count, I guess. Yeah, I'd go out and get a couple of ducks before breakfast, go back and leave them with my mom, and clean up a little bit and go to school.
How old were you then? How old was that?
Oh, I would guess 12, 13. Oh, actually, I was 11 when I first started driving. I think we had phones, and they were the kind you would ring, and you had so many rings, and that was for you. And so one of the cottages called down and talked to my Uncle Charlie, and he threw me the keys to the car, and he said, hey, Royce, cottage 37 wants 50 pounds of ice. I said, yes, sir. He said, well, deliver it. I said, Charlie, I don't drive. He says, here, take the Chevy. So we went out and started up and drove up to the ice house and uncovered from the straw and so forth that keeps it from melting, cleaned it up, put it in the trunk, and delivered it.
What did the Depression mean to you and your family?
My dad was a grocer. And all of his regular customers, we maintained a book on them. And everything they bought, we wrote down. Some of the families, the books grew, but no payments. One time he told me, Royce, he handed me, I think, about five of these bunches of books. He says, you can have anything you can get from it. He'd just given up on it, and it's on him, on the house, and anything you can collect, you can have. It isn't going to come in, not likely.
So did you go out and collect bills?
I did not. I saw his wisdom and just went about doing what I was doing. Well, there was nothing to forgive for that guy. Yeah. I was at the University of Minnesota. I was majoring in geopolitics, so I was already beaming in on this. I said, holy mackerel. They're calling up the reserves, and here I'm a regular Navy guy, and I'm trained in all this and hot to trot, how come they're not sending me? And then not only that, we graduated, and then they sent to a postgraduate school. I said, there's a war on. And I was assigned to a Corsair squadron because I was qualified in Corsairs. When I came down and I saw those jets, and I, gee, I'd like to fly that. I looked up to who the commanding officer was of the Panther squadron. And lo and behold, it was Stan Holm. I'm like, ah. He was the executive officer of the ROTC unit at University of Minnesota. So I gave him a call and I said, I'm scheduled to Red Squadron, but I'd sure like to get in yours and fly jets. He said, see what I can do. The next day I had new orders and I was in his squadron.
One MiG versus a one Panther. Is that a fair fight?
Somebody has surprised. They've got an advantage. Depends on the situation. But if they're both up to fighting, the MiG has the advantage. I knew I was in their threat area, but when they broke up, I thought they might be going home and getting ready to land or something. So when they came in, invisibly, all shooting, it was a surprise. And immediately maneuvered and got in a good position for a short burst and shot down number four. And he started smoking a little bit, but he dropped out of formation. And my wingman at that time directed all of his attention to that guy, left me, and followed number four down. Yeah, so there were three there, and that's where my attention is. And they zoom on up at a high rate of climb. And I tried following them best, but they were getting ready to re-attack. And meanwhile, these three are coming in from another direction. So I prepared to fight with checking my gun sight and testing my guns. And I didn't have any instructions about what to do. But I told them it's seven MiG-15s as they approached and turned around right over me, heading back to the direction they came from. And they said, do not engage. So there were my instructions, I guess, but I said, we are engaged. There's no way I can duck out safely at this point. I mean, they are there, and I'm going to have to handle the situation. I've got my concentration on whatever is active at that time. In the meanwhile, whether swirling or whatever, gaining a position to take their turn. Lead aircraft has his wingman, and the guy that just lost his wingman went down and being followed by my wingman, went off to the left and probably 2,000 feet above and turned, and that's the one I was initially tracking, but he was in the sun when I saw the other two coming from a little farther over and different, and the lead aircraft started firing at me very soon after I moved over to track them. But he shot briefly and they were closing rapidly. And so I fired a short burst and he turned. And I noticed his wingman now was kind of closing on me. The other, I didn't keep track of him. But the other guy came in and he's dead head on with me. And we're coming like this and he's shooting. At this time, he's in range when I switched to him. And he's shooting and I'm shooting and he suddenly just quit. And he kept coming and I kept firing. And he slipped right underneath me with no maneuver at all. And in as much accounting for how many were lost, I have a feeling that he was dead. From then on, the other three
are making their attack because they are positioning while these others are now having to regain a position on the altitude and position. So from then on, it's one after time, and I'm just flying along, and we've got all these up here. And so I'm seeing this guy come at me, and he gets in, and I'm just turning as hard as I can into him to mess up his aiming and so forth, and he's shooting and shooting, and both of them, as a routine, regular, good fighter pilot maneuver, pulled on up to where I'm unable to track or anything, and he's just going up for another shot, and another guy's coming in. One of them made a mistake, and he came on in, and he's shooting at me like this, and he kind of ducked underneath me, and he made a turn at my altitude, and I was pretty close, and I fired on him, and a lot of pieces started coming off the airplane, and he was hit severely, and I had to maneuver hard to avoid hitting him. So at one point, a guy goes in, and he comes on by, and I get a lucky shot on him from a good angle off, and he starts slowing, and I come on around and continue firing, and I run out of ammunition. But he's now smoking and just dropping out. And I look on around, and here's another MiG, and he slipped on in while my attention's on this thing, and I'm straightening out a little too long, and I make a nice target for him, and he hits me with quite a good angle off and put a 37 round right into this part and went into the accessory section of the engine and really messed up my airplane. And I had difficulty with controls, out of ammunition, and he pulls in right behind me at an ideal probably 400 feet maybe, and he's just shooting away. And the only really operational, accurate, effective control I had was the elevator. The cables to control the rudder were shot away, and I could kick the paddles around, but they were disconnected. And the hydraulics for the aileron control were shot, and I had difficulty. It was out of trim, and I was having to use both hands on the stick to maneuver. But he comes in and right behind, and luckily I'm aimed right at the task force, and we've got this big snowstorm in between at 12,000 feet down, so I'm diving for that on the way to the task force, and he's just sitting there shooting, and I'm pulling back on the stick and then just pulling it, shoving it forward, and I'm going like this, and he keeps shooting over the top of me and underneath of me and so forth, and we both ended up in the clouds, and he probably lost sight of me, and my attention is now to the condition of the airplane. Should I eject? I wouldn't survive it. I'm too far from the task force for any rescue, and my time of survivability and the conditions of the cold water and so forth, I wouldn't have made it. So I said, best stick with it and see how it comes out. I got so low under the clouds, I didn't have the capability for the systems at that time to eject safely. So I'm stuck in the airplane. I could, of course, crash landed in the water, which isn't 100% survivability, but who knows. My problem is, how do I get this thing back on the aircraft carrier? One, two hands on the stick, and all this time I was at full throttle and probably using a lot of fuel, but I never checked on fuel. I just didn't have time to put my attention there. I put my landing gear down at my tail hook all by gravity because I didn't have the hydraulics, and I'm testing to see at what point would I stall, and at 170 knots was the point. Anything below there and I was losing control. I'm back here and the ship is over there, so I'm flying, but I can't maneuver the airplane to come over and line up with the deck into the wind. But I could keep going at the
at the ship. So I'm notifying the landing signal officer that I can't line up. He said, we'll cut you for an early wire. And the ship's here in the wire, so like I'd probably go like that and right over the side. I might have caught a wire and hang, but not likely at 170 knots. So I was coming in hot, off center, looking bad, and the captain of the ship kicks it around and lines it up with me, and bingo, I land and catch number three wire just like it was meant to be. Plus 50 years had transpired, and the story itself of the encounter was out there, but the truth of the matter remained hidden until I was notified that it was no longer classified. So I told my wife, and she said, oh, Royce.
You've lived a charmed life.
I have. No denial.
Why do you think you've lived such a charmed life?
Well, if it gets down to that, I am religious. And Jesus Christ is my Savior. And I think He puts people on earth with a purpose. And evidently, I had one to serve, and I gave it my best. No, I always withhold it. I should do better, but as good as I did, I've gotten away with it.
Wow. What do you think your purpose is?
Wow. To be a disciple, and to, I'm no example, but in the little part to play that people look up to older folks, sometimes if you're smart enough, even younger folks, but leaders, and sometimes in order to get their attention, I guess, somebody has to do some unusual things, and maybe that's what I was supposed to do, but I don't want to say like David and the Goliath, but certainly David had the strength of God behind him to handle that situation, and goodness sakes, I was given an awfully good chance to die, and I just did what I felt my purpose and training was for, and I think I was probably God-driven and protected, and I'm certainly not that good. I haven't said that before, but that's it. I really feel blessed.
Joe Foss, recipient of the Congressional Medal of Honor, and someone who distinguished himself way beyond his World War II cockpit, had a saying regarding recognition. It ain't bragging if you done it. But just because you done it doesn't mean you go around bragging. Well, today, nearly 70 years later, Royce Williams is finally getting the recognition he deserves. Not just for the story of 7 versus 1, but for the reality that service and excellence are heroic in and of themselves.
Ladies and gentlemen, Royce Williams. Glad to have you here, Royce.
Thank you.
Royce, we're getting questions from all over the place, and they're being piped in here into my earpiece, and here comes some of that awesome sound effect.
Aerospace,
yes. Royce, the first question that I've got for you is, your story is getting a lot more interest today, 70 years later. And why do you think it's becoming so interesting for people?
Well, for starters, it wasn't known for a lot of years. And then when I was first authorized to speak about it, no one knew to even ask, so there wasn't an audience. At first, really became known in small Navy circles when I was asked to speak at a symposium in Pensacola, Florida. And Marine Lieutenant Colonel retired had quite a audience on email, and he wrote a very nice, pretty accurate account of it, and it spread it a little bit. But really, nothing until Admiral Shelton, who has become a friend of mine, took it on as a project. And it's come to fruition in almost 8 years of diligence, for which he has been noted and given an honorary PhD.
Right.
And through those efforts trying to move a recommendation for a medal upgrade, the American Legion and others have widened the audience, and what you're doing probably will do it more so.
When you brought up the question about a medal upgrade, now for that November 18th action, you were awarded the Silver Star. But when you're talking about a medal upgrade, it's for the Medal of Honor.
That is the hope.
The hope. Well, here's a question from a listener that so many years ago, do you ever think, boy, I wish I would have gotten the attention when I was 27? Does that ever cross your mind, or are you happy with the way things turned out?
Yeah, I live with what is, and it became sort of a nothing, and more or less made little difference in my life. Certainly has changed somewhat now that the word is out.
We have another question that just came in. So when you're flying, how did you know that the pilots, that the MiGs, when you saw the seven MiGs, how did you know that they were flown by Russians and not North Koreans or, in some cases, even Chinese?
Well, I think I thought they were, and it was because that the MiG encounters effort, really, was pretty much limited to the western half of North Korea, and the planes flying out of more or less safe bases in China. And really didn't have activity in our rather sphere of our fighting in North Korea. We were more interested in logistics and personnel and fire and close air support, and there wasn't any MiG activity.
Rick, if you would call up graphic number 11. I think it'd be interesting for people to see where this happened. And graphic number 11 shows a little orange-yellow starburst where the activity happened. And it's actually just south of Russia.
Yes.
So I've got a question about that from somebody here from California. Were you aware of the geopolitical issues that would have happened, I mean, that were going to happen with when you're engaging with Russians versus North Koreans? I mean, did that go through your mind that, oh my gosh, I'm fighting the Russians?
Not at the moment. I really didn't finish the answer to the first question in that I had been on the first flight, and it was just
few miles across a river was Russia, Soviet Union. And I was aware that it stirred up an awful lot of interest where they were launching aircraft and a lot of radio chatter. So this response in the direction they came from in our political geographical position at that time led me to believe they were likely Russian.
Did you ever, did you think about any of the implications of what would happen if this would turn into a news headline, you know, American pilot goes after Russian fighters?
Yeah, I was pretty well aware. I've always been interested in geopolitics and being on the carrier in the war condition and not having current media opportunities, we were fed very little about what reaction might be taking place. But in my mind, I could see that we had been worried all along about complications. Certainly the Chinese surprised us by coming in with hordes of enemy, and basically the fight in North Korea was as much against China as it was North Korea. And an awful lot of support came from other communist countries, and Russia was right next door. So it had to have been a matter of great concern all along. And at this time, they were developing nuclear weapons. So, as a State Department matter, it had to be darn serious.
Let's, I've got a question about the MiG-15. Rick, if you can put up picture number 6.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a picture of two MiG-15s flying. How versed were you in understanding the performance of a MiG-15? Versus the performance of your Panther? Hang on, we got a jet coming.
Well,
up
here. Aerospace.
Aerospace. Love it.
I had probably done as much looking into the matter as any other of the naval aviators there, and I had seen estimates, intelligence, and it was pretty accurate. It showed it probably as versus the F-86 from the Air Force, that in many areas they were co-equal, and some the MiG bettered the 86, and likewise the 86 had a couple features that were better. So, but all of them were in a realm that was significantly better than the airplane I was flying for air-to-air fighting.
Right. So the F-9F Panther, that was being used more for ground attack at the time?
That was really the mission given to the Navy. And we were, I think, rather good at it. but that was really our main mission. And as far as our workup and practice back in the States to be ready to fight, that's the type of training that we concentrated on.
Okay, I'd like to go back to your childhood. You know, I'm a South Dakotan, you're a South Dakotan, and we tend to be pretty proud of being a South Dakotan.
Yes.
But, Rick, if you could put up graphic number 2. Space. And there we go. That is an Eagle Scout rank, correct?
Oh, yeah, number 2?
Yeah.
Yes.
Did Boy Scouts, do you believe Boy Scouts played a part of your character building? What role did it play? I mean, you achieved Eagle Scout, and then you went on to start 4 troops. I I would have to think that that helped make you part of who you were at the time of this moment.
Oh, certainly. I did a lot of work on farms during the summer when school was out, and even sometimes if they had a need because of weather delays or rain or something, they asked me to take some time out from school and help on farm matters. But with the athletics and the camping and everything that I love to do, a lot of work on the water and swimming, and it was the Junior Red Cross life-saving trained, and it just fit right in with scouting, which was of high interest. And I started achieving, and I think that encouraged more, build on that, and took time off from other things to pretty much by myself go camping out in the middle of nowhere and start working on merit badges, and I liked it. There are today a lot of expanded merit badges, but the ones at that time were pretty much just right for a kid from South Dakota loving the outdoors.
Sure. And it taught you a sense of independence.
Definitely. Yes. Yes, I a lot of time would just hike on out to kind of forested areas and by myself spend a week or two.
Kids don't do that today.
No, I don't think so.
Okay, we're getting a number of questions that are that play into what you were just describing. And the questions are facing hostile environments. I mean, I don't think you can put yourself in a more challenging position. You've got, you know, fast forward to 1952, and you're in your Panther, and you have seven Superior MiG-15s. That's definitely a hostile situation. Looking back, how do you think you reacted? Why do you think you reacted so positively? And now that you've had time in life to think about what you did, what kind of advice would you give somebody else who is in a similar hostile reaction or environment?
Well, I'd faced challenges before, and I had training for this event. Very little, I'll have to say, because in peacetime, it used to be that they didn't want to take additional risk.
Sure.
So there was very little, realistic training. There was safety built into what we did. So the real life encounter is somewhat like what you practiced, but I had very little air-to-air experience. I had thought about it even as when I was a cadet. But training kicked in, and the matter at hand, and proceed.
So thinking between an F9F and a MiG-15, what strength did that Panther have over the MiG?
Well, we're talking about aerial engagement. The MiG-15 had a better power to weight ratio, swept wing, modern airplane with a advanced engine building on what was a Rolls Royce initially. And with that, they could out accelerate definitely climb, go to greater altitudes, greater speed, straight and level. And probably turning might have been pretty much equal. The advantage I had was a computing gun sight.
Really?
And I used to practice with kind of, we called it the iron sight. It was just mounted, and you would do your mental calculations of how much lead to give an airplane that's turning. And with this, you would put a light, a moving sight to what we call the pipper, the aiming point, and just track the airplane, and then computers would calculate the amount of lead. Mm-hmm. So it was a wonderful device.
That's a great, great time to put up the question number, or put up the picture number 7. Rick, could you get that up there? We're getting a question about, hey, we'll let this jet pass. Sound of progress. I love it.
Goes with San Diego.
Yes. How close were you when you were engaged with these MiGs? And then the other question is how was it confirmed that you even had the victories? I mean, did somebody see them splash into the water? But so answer the question, how close were you getting when you were shooting? And then how did you have the victories confirmed?
Well, it was one event following the other, and each had its own dynamic. And by the time I opened fire, I was well within the range. I wasn't wasting ammunition. And in one case, the 20 millimeters tore up the big airplane, and pieces came off, and it was awfully close to hitting him. I had to make an urgent maneuver to avoid collision.
Sure. How were the victories confirmed? Was there a boat in the water that saw the MiGs go in, or how did they know that you had actually shot them down?
Well, my wingman at the beginning of this fight, when four in a formation were all firing. And that started the event, and I made a tight turn and ended up right behind their last airplane within range, and shot a short burst of bullets, and he started, well, mainly he dropped out of formation. And the others pulled up into a real high climb, and I was following them, but my wingman followed the other guy that dropped out, and watched him go down. Mm-hmm. Another one was smoking and intercepted, but when I was out of ammunition and saying I could use some help, sent him over, intercepted, fired at extreme range and at a 90-degree position with no chance of hitting. But as he was coming on around to tail in behind him, the pilot ejected.
Sure.
That's the only confirmation I know of what we knew. But, of course, the Russians knew. And in the early 1990s, as they broke up from the Union, the Soviet Union, they made it common knowledge in putting it in their newspaper.
Sure.
With the names of four. There may have been others, but that I have one other name floating around, but it's not confirmed like the others.
So you know the names of the pilots that,
yes.
And you know that they were lost.
Yes.
we're getting a question. Why didn't anybody else come to help you? I mean, you were up there all alone. Do you ever wonder about that, or do you have an answer?
Well, we had three carriers up there, and normally you would have one of them at the ready where they could launch. But they probably weren't manned, and you got to notify the ready room where the pilots are, and maybe they aren't dressed for it. Because of the weather in wintertime, we were wearing a special immersion flight suit to give you a little better chance of surviving in cold water. So it isn't likely that they were all set to go, and nobody ever expected that there would be such an encounter. So the time it takes and so forth, actually the next ones in the air was my commanding officer with four airplanes, and he was airborne and below this 400-foot ceiling in the snowstorm, and he spotted me coming back. So the fight was over as they were coming up to risk to replace us. But he noticed that the destroyers were shooting at me, so he got that stopped. And then he climbed through the clouds just in time to see in a distant two MiGs heading back to where they came from, Vladivostok.
It's possible you may have gotten a fifth victory, making you an ace in a day. Is that true?
It's possible. People are kicking that around. As a matter of fact, some would say even six, because a Russian historian has written a book about it, and there were two returning to base, and one of them had some damage to it and was losing fuel, and it went in and the pilot was killed. So only one airplane that we know about.
Amazing.
Returned.
We have a question from a nine-year-old boy who's listening.
Good.
And I think it's a pretty cool question. He wants to know how much fuel was in your Panther when you came back. Because if you're up there and you're in a dogfight for 35, 38 minutes, and you told me off camera that you had that throttle 100% the whole time, how much fuel did you have in the carrier?
Well, that's a good question, but the thought never entertained me. I had to handle the problem at the time, and I never looked at the fuel gauge. I'm sure it was just about out, because our normal flight was an hour and a half, and this was an hour and 25 minutes or something like that. And normally you don't fly the whole flight at 100%.
Sure.
So I'm guessing it was very low on fuel.
Well, let's go back to the moment where a MiG finally gets a shot on you and you take a hit from probably one of their 37-millimeter cannon. What did that feel like, and then what did it do to the airplane?
Well, there were a lot of shots at me way before this, but this was significant to hit me in a vital area right at the wing root and went into the accessory section of the engine before it really exploded, and it disabled the rudder by cutting the cable, and it ruined the entire hydraulic system, which depending on for some of the aileron control. So my control of the airplane, besides it now being out of trim to where it took unusual force on the stick that if I'm to overcome the condition. I had the elevator, the part of the tail that makes you go up and down with the nose. And this guy that hit me then with the excess speed and so forth just came right on around and sat at a perfect range behind me, probably 300-400 feet, and just shot full time. And I was just dodging, going up and going down, as drastic as I could do it. And it worked. And I could see the bullets go under me and over me. And, but I got into the clouds. This fight took place where the frontal system had moved on and it was clear air. But the carriers were still under this storm system. And when I got into that, that probably saved my life. Although the guy had done a lot of shooting from right on my tail before we got there. We started at 26,000 feet and the tops of the clouds were at 12,000.
Wow. And you came back on the carrier and you landed at 170 knots, which is way over typical landing speed.
Yes.
Yeah. And we're getting questions about the gun camera film. You're landed. I'm assuming that the gun camera footage is taken from the plane almost really quickly.
Absolutely.
And what happened to the gun camera footage?
Well, I don't know a lot about it. It disappeared. And as I learned later and kept my mouth shut about it, that the NSA, which is now common knowledge, was on its first operational mission. And concerning the whole operation, that was highly classified. So I think the film is in their hands, their depository someplace. I never saw it. I was given a little snippet of it, which I use in some of the training that I did later on. But it didn't really show much of anything, and I don't know where that is. But the basic coverage disappeared. And besides that, a little bit of handiwork on the sailor that developed it, thought he was Cecil D. DeMille or something, he did a little editing and scraps on the floor. So it is where it is, and nobody that I know knows where that is.
It's an amazing, amazing story, but it's not just the only part of your life. You stayed in the Navy and you made a career out of being a naval aviator. And you ended up also serving in Vietnam. I'm curious, how many combat sorties did you fly in Vietnam?
I think 130 or something like that.
One of the interesting aspects that I've found about learning about your service is that you were involved with the your Vietnam War service, that you were involved with meeting the families of POWs.
Yes.
Describe how you interacted with the families. What was your role in reaching them?
Mrs. Sybil Stockdale was the wife of the senior prisoner of war.
James Stockdale.
Yes, Stockdale. And she became a source for intelligence and certainly with Navy intelligence, as was I, as the director of prisoner of war matters. And I had pretty much full authority to do whatever I thought would be helpful. And I was a member of all of the existing committees with the joint under Assistant Secretary of Defense. I worked with the State Department and personally met with Averill Harriman in his home, but I felt if there's anybody that needs whatever we can provide in the way of information and comfort or help, it would be the people directly affected of family. Some parents, but I mainly worked with wives. And I would travel to centers and letting them know in advance so they could invite those in the reasonable area. And on one of those, I had an assistant of Ambassador Harriman, who traveled with me from the State Department, and he became a very important figure later on. I can't think of his name right now from Maine, but I think he was ended up as Secretary of State at one time.
We're getting ready to wrap up. We have a running out of time, but we're getting numbers of people who want to express their gratitude for your service, for your example. One of them is an Eagle Scout who thanks you for representing so well. But if you were to impart some life wisdom on the audience and recognize that your story here is going worldwide to people of all ages, what would you say to inspire the next generation of people, of Americans?
Well, of course, scouting isn't the only avenue. It was very significant for me. I'm kind of a joiner. I was with the 4-H Club and the Future Farmers of America. And part of it, I suppose, is society. You're not there by yourself. You're interacting, trying to achieve something. You've got purpose. And it's not, what do we call it? Not a gang. If that was the closest to a gang at that time, it was probably the Boy Scouts, and it was well-purposed. and people who participated, I'm sure, even to lesser degrees, look back on that as an experience, and with experience you learn. And you know. So for today, I can't put myself in their shoes. It's so different. But everybody has a mind, and some of it's controlled by others, but control what you can. Have some purpose in life. What do you want to do? And you probably list some things.
Fly jets.
And you might think they're beyond achieving, but maybe you can find something to do that would help you decide. You have to have purpose, and not willy-nilly and a leaf in the wind and do whatever somebody thinks is necessarily right for you. But wondering if you are attentive and purposely doing something, you find the lead you need. And then, of course, the other is opportunity, a big part of it. And don't be afraid to get started someplace. Everybody has to at some point. And if you have somebody that can counsel you, work with them so you grow up.
Sir, this has been just a great honor. It's a privilege. And we've been getting to know each other over the past couple months, you know, with putting together the film. And I just want to give you a personal statement of gratitude from everybody in South Dakota. We love your story. We're hearing about it. But I think you're also a national hero and a national treasure. Thank you for taking time to be here.
Well, it's my pleasure, and I think you've done something for me. Oh. Thank you.
All right. We have a saying at Old Guys in Their Airplanes: when an old man dies or an old woman dies, a library burns. these debriefs brought together by the Distinguished Flying Cross Society are a way for us to remember that there are libraries all around us, in our families, in the communities. That was really cool. Thank you. In the families and the communities we reside. So though when an old man or an old woman dies, a library burns, if we get to know it, if we check out the volumes in their minds, we can pay it forward to generations to come. Thank you for joining, and I just want to let you know that we have another old guys in their airplanes debrief coming up, and we'll be making that announcement after Christmas. Thank you, and have a great day.